गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. वील बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट डाइवर्जेंस, ग्रेडियंट एंड कर्व इन थ्री डायमेंशनल वेक्टर मैथमेटिक्स. वी यूज देम ऑल द टाइम. इन सो इन प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी टॉक्ड अबाउट द रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन पोटेंशियल एनर्जी एंड वर्क डन. सो वी लुक्ड एट दिस एंड वी सेड फ्रॉम हियर वी कैन फाइंड द रिलेशनशिप ऑफ योर पोटेंशियल एनर्जी एंड योर कंजर्वेटिव फोर्सेस. And we found that the conservative force is negative gradient of your potential energy. Okay. Now we want to understand what the gradient function is because we have generalized it to a three-dimensional situation. So in the end, we were here at this point of defining the gradient function. Okay. And this gradient is given by this term right here. Okay. So it is some unit vector I times the partial derivative d by dx. Plus j, that is unit vector in the y direction, and times the partial derivative in the y direction, plus again is the unit vector k times the partial derivative in the z direction. Okay, and when we are saying partial derivative, this d by dx, if I apply it to a function, we are considering that the y and the z coordinates will be constant. So we will be only differentiating with respect to x. Okay. So this gradient, if you apply it to a function like function t, then it will take of this form that you will have this I and you will have the partial derivative with respect to x of this function t, and then you will have j unit vector partial derivative of t with respect to y, and you have the k unit vector partial derivative with respect to z. Okay. So we can take an example so that you can understand it better. In physics and in mathematics and in other areas, we have a quantity that we define very often, which is known as the position vector r. Okay. So one of the fundamental things we always want from our situation that we are dealing with in any problem or in any model is that we want to know where the position of an object is. Okay. So to define that, we use the common notation used in vector mathematics, that any position r in your three-dimensional coordinate system, like it is shown here as this point here, can be given as some component of your x value. So if you just project the position r in three-dimensional axis, you will get that it has some value around in the x coordinate system. It will have some value in the y axis, and it will have some value in the z-axis. Okay, we define a quantity that is the unit vector, and the unit vector is defined in such a manner that we have our unit vector in the x direction like such, and we have a unit vector in the y direction, and we have a unit vector in the z direction. Okay, so that has a magnitude of one essentially. Okay, so we can give any position of a coordinate in terms of the unit vector as to how many units of that unit vector do we have in our translation that we are doing along each axis. Okay, so a typical vector is written and decomposed in the three dimensional form like this. Okay, now this position vector has a magnitude, as you know from your vector mathematics. The magnitude of this vector will be square root of your x square plus y square plus z square term. Okay, so that is the magnitude of this vector. Okay, and mathematically the unit vector r, which is given by this hat on top, is given as your vector r divided by the magnitude of the vector. Okay, so you can represent it in this form. It will be x x roof plus y y roof and z z roof divided by your magnitude, which I have written in the form x square plus y square plus z square raised to 1/2. Okay, so this is a typical way to represent any position in three-dimensional space. All right, so now we want to do a small exercise. Let's look at the gradient of this magnitude r. So the first term will be just some I times d by dx, and it will be just the magnitude of r, right? And the second term will be some j, right? And then it will be the partial derivative with respect to y, and you will have some again magnitude of r, and then you will have k and again partial derivative with respect to magnitude of r. Okay, and what is r? R is this term in the bottom, right? X square plus y square plus z square raised to half. Okay, so if you differentiate this magnitude of r with respect to x, okay, what do we get? Formula that we use for differentiation, remember, d by dx of x raised to n is the n times x raised to n minus 1. Okay, this is the common formula, right? So we have a one half term in n, so we will get one half outside here, right? N will come out, and then we have x raised to n minus 1. So whatever this term is, we have to raise it to n minus 1. So you get x square plus y square plus z square raised to n minus 1. So one half minus 1. Okay, and then you have to go inside the argument and take the differentiation of this terms with respect to x. Okay, so then if you take the derivative with respect to x, that is just d by dx, and it is just x square. Okay, and the rest of the terms y square and z square will be zero because you are differentiating with respect to x. Okay, and this term here is you can simplify it and write it in this form. It is just one half. Okay, and since this is one half minus one, so you'll have a minus half here, so that can go in the bottom, and again you will get the term as x square plus y square plus z square raised to half. Okay, so it's an inverse term, so I've taken it again in the bottom, and d by dx of x square is just 2 times x. Okay, so I can just write 2x in the numerator here. Okay, unit vector term here, right, that is coming from here. Okay, so let's take the next function, which is j. So you will get something in terms of j, and you have to take the partial derivative with respect to y of this function. Okay, so again if you do the partial derivative, this first term will remain the same, right? So you will again get one half, and you will get again x square plus y square plus z square raised to one half, and in the numerator now you're taking d by dy with respect to this function, so that means you are taking d by dy of y square, so again you will get a 2y term here. Okay, and again for the third case you will get one half, and you will get 2 times z, and you will get your x square plus y square plus z square raised to one half. Okay, so that is your complete solution to your gradient of this r value. Okay, and if you look closely, what is happening here is you have a half and two, so they will cancel, so you can just cancel these terms. Okay, and what you're left with is you're left with something that looks like xi plus y of j plus z of k, because the denominator for all of them is the same, and so you can take a common denominator outside, so that would look something like this: x square plus y square plus z square raised to one half, and that is nothing but this unit vector r. Okay, which we have already defined, that the unit vector r is this x roof, y roof, and z roof divided by this function. Okay, and I used I, but if you want you can use x. Okay, they mean the same thing, they are just different forms of notation. Okay, so I roof is similar to x roof, it is the unit vector in the x direction. Okay, so what I was trying to say is, if you take the gradient of this r, what it means is that you are getting your unit vector r as the solution. Okay, so what does it mean? It simply means that the distance from the origin, okay, of any point that you are considering increases most rapidly in the radial direction, and moreover the rate of that increase is 1. Okay, you know, this gradient, this is not a vector. Okay, this gradient that we are looking here with this I, d by dx and this form, it's not a vector. Okay, it is basically what we call in physics as an operator. Okay, and what this gradient will do, it will operate on a function. Okay, and the operator here is this partial differential operator. Okay, so when it operates on this function, it will give you the derivative of that function, and that is how we define the gradient of the function. So you have to be very careful. This is not a vector, this is an operator. And in physics, later on, you will see a lot of different operators that act on a function, and they give some quantity once you operate on that function. Okay, when we are talking about gradient, this gradient is acting not on a vector, but it is acting on a scalar function. Okay, that is very important. A gradient can act only on a scalar function, and let's say that function is phi. Okay, then basically what it defines is, it defines a vector field that the magnitude is equal to the maximum rate of change of that function, and the direction of this gradient where it is pointing is the same as the direction of the displacement along with the rate of change is maximum. Okay, so these are the two things that the gradient tells you. Okay, it gives you the magnitude of the change, and it gives you the direction along with the displacement in which the rate of change of is maximum. Okay, so let's do an example. Let's try to calculate the gradient of these following functions. Okay, so the function is f1 is x square plus y cube plus z to the power 4, and this is your operator, and you have to apply it to this function f1. Okay, again, to calculate the gradient of this function, we have to apply this operator, okay, to your function f1. So that would mean that the first term would be your unit vector I times your partial derivative of f1 with respect to x. Okay, so again, we are taking partial derivative, so y and z terms are constant, so all you have to do is you have to take the derivative of the first term. Okay, and that would mean I times the partial derivative of x square would be 2x. Okay, and then the second term would be the partial derivative with respect to y, so you would get 3 times y square as the derivative of this y cube. Okay, and the third term would be k times partial derivative with respect to z, so that would mean 4 times z n to the power minus 1, right, n minus 1, so you get 4 minus 1 is 3. Okay, and that is your function. Okay, so you get 2x I plus 3 y square j plus 4 z cube k. Okay, so again, the gradient of this scalar function gives you a vector field of this notation, some value in I, some value in j, some value in k. Okay, let's do another example. Let's do the example here where we are doing a gradient with respect to f2. Okay, so the first term should be I, and you're taking partial derivative with respect to x, so your y cube and z to the power 4 are constant, and then the derivative with respect to x is square is 2x. Okay, and the second term will be j. Now you're differentiating with respect to y, so x square is constant, z to the power 4 is constant, and then you take the derivative of y cube, so you get 3y square. Okay, and the last term should be k, and x square will be constant, y cube will be constant, and 4z cube is going to be your differentiation with respect to z of z to the power 4. Okay, so again, you can write it in a much cleaner manner. You have 2x y cube z to the power 4i plus 3x square y square z to the power 4j plus you have 4 x square y cube z cube and k. Okay, so that is your gradient of this second function. Again, it is a vector field. Okay, this operator that we are dealing with, this operator is called the del operator. Okay, and again, it is not a vector, it is an operator that acts on a function. Okay, now how this operator acts on a function will define what we are looking at. Okay, so in the first case, we looked at this operator acting on a scalar function, and the scalar function gives you a gradient. Okay, and we defined what the gradient is. It gives you the magnitude, it gives you the direction of the change. Now if you apply this del operator and you take a dot product, okay, and you take a dot product with a function f, then that will give you something called divergence, okay. And if you take the same del operator and you do a cross product with a function, it will give you a curl, okay. So let's see what this divergence and curl is. And these are very, very important quantities in physics, in electromagnetics, and in other areas. We'll be using them all the time, okay. So the divergence of a vector is given by this dot product, del dot v. Let's say v is a vector. So a vector will have these three components in the x direction, y direction, and the z direction. And if you take the dot product of your del operator with this vector, you will get basically d by dx of the vector component in the x dimension only, right? Because every time you take a dot product of this x unit vector with y and z, it will come out to be zero, because the dot product of x dot y or x dot z is zero because of the angle between the orthonormal vectors, right? So remember, x is 90 degree to y and z, and similarly y is 90 degree to x and z, and so on, okay. So when you take the dot product, only the x dot x term will survive, y dot y terms will survive, and z dot z term will survive, okay. And so you get a function that looks like this. Again, this divergence you can apply to a vector function, okay, not a scalar function, but a vector function. And the result that you get is now a scalar quantity. Remember, now we have eliminated the vector terms, and this complete term is just a scalar, which is just a number, okay. So the definition of what we are saying a divergence is it is a measure of how much a vector v is spreading out, okay. That's what diverges or divergence in English means, okay. So it is a measure of how much a vector v is spreading out from wherever the point is, okay. So we are starting from this center point. Like this first function here is showing that there is a large positive divergence that is emitting from this point, okay. So you can see that the strength of this arrow is increasing, right, and the direction is actually normal to this point here, okay. So this kind of field represents a large positive divergence from this point that we care about, okay. Similarly, if you look at a vector field like this, all these vectors, they have the same magnitude and they have the same direction, so there is hardly any divergence or spreading out of the function here, okay. However, there is a third example here. You can see that they are all pointed in the same direction, but the strength of the vector is increasing, okay. So that would mean that there is some positive divergence, that it is increasing, okay. And just similarly like that, if the arrows were pointing in the opposite direction and all of these vectors, they were decreasing in magnitude and they were coming down to one single point in the other direction, that would mean that it would have a very, very large negative divergence, okay. So let's try to calculate a few of them. It will help us in understanding what the divergence means, okay. Del is again I, the partial derivative with respect to this, and the j, partial derivative with respect to y, and k, partial derivative with respect to z, okay. So let's take the first vector, which is just the position vector that we were just talking about before. So if I take the divergence of this vector del dot va, okay, so that means I'm doing a dot product, okay. So only the x and x terms will survive, okay. So let me just follow the notation so that it is less confusing. Let's use x, y, and z here, so it is less confusing. Okay, so now only the x roof and x roof components will survive. So you get the first term will be d by dx when you take a dot product between them. The second term will be partial derivative of y, and the third term will be partial derivative of z term, right? Because the cross terms like z, y, and z, x, they all will be zero, right? And d by dx of x is just one. So you get 1 plus 1 plus 1 in this case, so the answer is 3, let's do for this vector VB. So if I want to calculate del dot VB, right? So I'm taking partial derivative with respect to X. There is no X term, so that is just zero. Then there is no term in the Y dimension. Again, that is zero. So now you have this term in the Z, right? So we have one times Z, that is what this unit vector is. So I am taking again T by partial derivative of one, okay? Because that is the coefficient that goes in front of the unit vector, okay? And we have Z dot Z, that is one also. So this derivative of one will be zero, okay? So that is what you get, the dot product of VB, okay? And similarly, you can do the dot product of the third one also. You can see that again, there is no X and Y terms. So only the Z term will survive. So you get partial derivative with respect to Z, and this will be one, okay? So this example, I will let you guys try to solve for this one. We have X d by dx plus Y d by dy plus Z d by dz, that is partial derivatives, and you are taking a dot product with your term, which is f. So let's take the first term. You get d by dx of x square, and the second term will be d by dy, and y times y will survive, okay? So you only care about that term. The other terms are zero, and the third term will be partial derivative with respect to your minus 2xz, okay? So now the first term will be 2x, the second one will be d by dy. There is no y term here, so that will be zero, and the last term is minus 2x, and d by dz of z is one, so that is just minus 2x. So you get 2x minus 2x is zero, okay? So del dot f is zero, x, and all of these are zero, the cross terms are zero, and that is how we define a dot product, okay? So the curl of your vector function v is defined as the cross product, okay? So remember, to take the cross product, we have to we can use the matrix notation, x, y, and z terms, and the first row will be the row for the values of your del vector, which is the partial derivatives, d by dx, d by dy, d by dz, and the last row is your vectors vx, vy, vz components on the x, y, and z axis, okay? You can calculate, the first term will be just x, and you have to eliminate this this row. So you will eliminate this row, so you're left with your terms of d vz by dy minus, you will get dv of y by dz, that is these two terms, and then your next term will be we use a minus sign y, and it will be, again, you're eliminating this row, so you get 2 by 2x of this vz minus, and you will get d by dz of vx term, right? And then the last term will be eliminate this row, so you get d by dx of vy minus d by dy times your vx. So this entire big giant is your cross product, okay? And this is known as the curl of this function, okay? So it is a measure of how much a vector is curling around, or basically it's going around itself, okay? Or the point that you want to study, okay? So again, you can try to see these functions, and if you note that these arrows, as they are diverging, they never try to go around the point in question, right? So there is no field that is going around this point, okay? So it just keeps diverging. So for all these three cases, the curl is zero, okay? For all these three cases, all right? Because always your vector keeps diverging and it never goes around the point in question, okay? So you can look at other example, a field like shown here. There is this vector that is going around this point in xy plane, and then the resultant curl will be pointing in the z direction, okay? Similarly, for this function here, you have a very, very large curl because you have this function that is going around this point in question, okay? Right, so we want to find del cross va, Okay, so let's calculate this. So that would just be x, y, and z. That is the first row. Okay, and we have the partial derivatives coming from the del operator. So that is d by dy and d by dz. And the last term is this, right? So we have a minus y component here. In the y, we have the x value, that is the component, and in the z, there is no component. Okay, so if I try to calculate this, so the first term will be x. I am taking the derivative with respect to zero, so that term dy of zero is just zero, and the next is dy dz of x, and that is also zero. So this entire term will be zero. So and then the next term is minus y, and in minus y again I am eliminating this row. So I am taking dy dx of this. So again it is derivative of zero is zero, and then I take dy dz of minus y. So this is also zero. Okay, and the last one is z term, and in the z term I am taking dy dx of x. Okay, minus, and I have dy dy of minus y. Okay, so first two terms are zero, so I am left with this z term. So dy dx is just one of x, and I have a minus and a minus sign, so that will become plus, and dy dy of y is just again one, right? So basically I have two times your value of z unit vector in that particular direction. Okay, so when I take the curl of this vector field that is represented by this notation here, what I'm getting is I'm getting a value of 2 that is pointing in the z direction. Okay, and that is what you're seeing, the curl of this. If you just use your right hand and curl around this field and using your right hand thumb rule kind of picture, then you will see that your thumb is pointing in the z direction. Okay, and that is what the cross product does, right? So a curl of a vector field will give you a vector. Okay, divergence of a vector field will give you a scalar. Okay, so that's what you have to remember.